No matter who we are or where we're from, we're all currently experiencing the challenges of a worldwide pandemic. But while we frantically look for ways to adapt to this new normal, we ignore the larger threat looming not too far behind: climate change and global warming. Another effect of climate change is that COVID-19 may not be the last widespread virus we must fight. The melting of glaciers in Tibet will release prehistoric viruses capable of infecting humans. While we often see the horrifying images of melting glaciers, the impact of climate change is much closer to home. We are already experiencing hotter daily temperatures and extreme weather, resulting in flooding and extended droughts. Coral bleaching has become widespread in Indonesian waters and threatened the well-being of our brothers and sisters in the Suku Bajo tribe from South Sulawesi, who depend on a healthy coral ecosystem for their daily lives. Indonesia, and all the other countries on the equator, will be the first to feel the consequences of climate change. The world, especially Indonesia, only has 10 to 30 years before the situation is irreversible. Climate change will not wait.
Why should we be caring about this climate change? You know, because human being, to fulfill their need on settlement, on the energy and also food, they change the landscape and ecosystems. The landscape, then you create the cities, you create farming, you have fisheries, also you have, to just name it. But then you don't realize that by changing this ecosystem and landscape, you create more greenhouse gases. It is this just accumulating greenhouse gases that create this climate change and the global warming. It is because of illiteracy on what? On the risk, you know. Secondly, is on the ignorance of the risk. You know the risk, but you ignore it. And the third, this is the most dangerous one, is because of the greed. Because when you're talking about the grid, the sky is the limit.
One of the more prominent man-made, non-sustainable decisions contributing to carbon emissions are the building and construction sector. Buildings generate 39% of greenhouse gases and 25% of landfill waste. These are not small numbers. Therefore, transitioning all our past, present, and future constructions to a green building concept is a must. Ensuring that all our buildings produce zero carbon emissions will help allow whatever is left in our natural environment to survive. But did you know that this green building concept not only helps us in the fight against climate change, but also in the fight against COVID-19? Two birds, one stone. Almost 90% of our time is spent indoors. Therefore, the indoor air quality, or IAQ, is essential to our health and our ability to fight off virus infections, especially with strong evidence that COVID-19 is an airborne virus. Good ventilation and airflow has become even more important in the fight against both climate change and the pandemic. Good ventilation and airflow is part of the green building concept. Maximizing natural ventilation with open and semi-outdoor rooms designed strategically to flush out any virus-contaminated air while keeping you comfortably cool without energy-wasting AC. Green buildings also take advantage of natural light. Sunlight is proven to improve our immune system, mental health, and lower that expensive electric bill you've been paying.
We must follow the lead of forward thinkers such as Ms. Teresia Mareta, who has already made the transition to green building.
Kita hidup di negara tropis, tapi sayangnya anak-anak kita lebih banyak terekspos dengan ruangan-ruangan ber-AC. Maka kami berpikir untuk mendirikan TK ini dengan konsep green supaya anak-anak kita bisa belajar bagaimana beradaptasi dengan lingkungannya. Saya rasa ini adalah hal dasar yang sebaiknya dimiliki oleh seorang manusia. Semua ruangan kelas di sekolah ini tidak menggunakan AC, kita menggunakan pencahayaan alami dan pengudaran alami. Jadi memang setelah mulai beroperasi, kami mendapat beberapa protes dari orang tua murid yang mengatakan bahwa kok anaknya sekarang jadi lebih kepanasan, cepat keringetan, bajunya basah. Tapi saya rasa ini adalah satu proses yang harus dilalui oleh si anak dalam pembelajaran bagaimana mereka mengenal lingkungannya dan beradaptasi dengan lingkungannya. Karena kita juga harus menyadari bahwa sebagai seorang manusia kita tidak bisa terlepas dari ikatan kita terhadap alam kita. Tapi positifnya setelah sekitar 3 bulan beroperasi, memang mulai ada orang tua murid yang memberikan komentar yang positif bahwa oh anaknya sekarang jadi nggak gampang sakit dan nggak sering batuk pilek dan sebagainya. Jadi saya rasa memang konsep ini bisa benar-benar memberikan satu perubahan yang positif untuk kehidupan kita.
Miss Theresia looked for an architect with the same vision. She found architect Adi Purnomo.
Kalau harus membangun TK 3 lantai, jadi waktu itu ditanya kenapa? Karena bayangkan aja kalau kondisi darurat, ada 900 anak harus dievakuasi, itu seberapa tingkat keberhasilannya gitu ya. Jadi itu saya menjawab pertanyaan kedua, bagaimana kalau tidak 3 lantai, karena lahan hijau mereka akan habis. Saya tahu bahwa pemilik ini sangat concern terhadap ruang hijau sebetulnya. Waktu itu saya menjawabnya dengan kita bisa melakukan konversi lahan hijau ini ke dalam atap bangunan kita. Atap hijau ini adalah salah satu cara untuk kita mendinginkan ruangan di bawahnya. Dalam cara ini kita bisa mengetahui bahwa ruangan-ruangan akan tidak langsung terkena cahaya matahari secara langsung, tetapi masih bisa mendapatkan cahaya yang diperlukan untuk keperluan di dalamnya tanpa harus memanaskan ruangan. Kemudian juga orientasi angin ini juga sangat penting karena salah satu konsepsi kita adalah membuat kelas-kelas ini bisa dilakukan tanpa harus bergantung pada pemakaian AC. Orientasi bangunan dan arah-arah bukaan jendela ini juga akhirnya berpengaruh sekali terhadap keberhasilan dari ventilasi silang dan penggunaan pencahayaan alaminya. Ternyata keseluruhan aspek-aspek itu akan selalu berujung kepada pengertian-pengertian green building ataupun healthy building yang kita mengerti saat ini. Bukannya dengan sederhana sekali, saya hanya mencoba melihat gejala alam, saya hanya mencoba melihat bangunan ini harus bisa berjalan bersama seluruh gejala alam yang ada. Bahkan TK ini menjadi mempunyai peluang untuk menjadi bangunan sekolah net zero building tanpa harus membuat effort lagi yang lebih besar.
Meanwhile, the Indonesian construction sector continues to grow with little development and sensitivity for a construction strategy that prioritizes lower carbon emissions. Urbanization and construction demands high energy consumption, increase in transportation, industrial development, and deforestation for expansion, ultimately resulting in an extremely large carbon footprint. For us to survive climate change, it is important for urbanization and construction to be controlled by regulation.
Ibu Ratun Ayu Kartini, a prominent Indonesian national hero, once said, "Banyak hal yang bisa-bisa menjatuh-jatuhkanmu, tapi satu-satunya hal yang benar-benar dapat menjatuhkanmu adalah sikapmu sendiri." Ibu Kartini was referring to attitude. It is the attitude that can bring one down, but it's also the attitude and that change of attitude that can bring about change. This awareness piece is about bringing change. Bringing change to the industry, bringing change to the community, and bringing change to Indonesia. This is important because in order for decarbonization programs to be successful in Indonesia for purposes of meeting the 2030 goals and the 2050 aspirations per the Paris Agreement, it is important that there is change in attitude of the people, the community, and the multilateral players that are involved in this field. In particular, in Indonesia, we would like to see the construction industry decarbonize. From the supply chain right to the buildings itself, we'd like to see these high-performance buildings, low-carbon residential houses, become a new normal for Indonesia. So this awareness piece by Green Building Council Indonesia and Global Buildings Performance Network is an important socialization piece to Indonesia to enable decarbonization programs to have meaningful impact for your community.
So last year, 2019, saw the building sector produce more greenhouse gas emissions than ever before. Despite the best efforts of the industry to reduce energy consumption from buildings, the total emissions and total energy demand has been increasing because increases in constructed floor area are outpacing improvements in building energy efficiency. The way we can deal with this is to aggressively regulate to reduce energy demand in new construction. In emerging markets like Indonesia, which have the world's fastest rates of urbanisation, the risks of doing nothing couldn't be higher. Benefits of providing policy plans that lead the industry towards zero emissions are substantial. We've seen from our global work and research has shown that countries that do set out on a path for decarbonisation, including regulations for near zero energy buildings, reap the rewards over time. The more ambitious policy settings are in terms of building energy performance, the greater the positive impact on economies are. We've seen countries with better regulatory frameworks for building performance see increases in their GDP, increases in job creation, and reductions in household expenditure. This all leads to better conditions for productivity and obviously lower impact on climate and on the environment in general.
Other than governmental action, it is also important for corporate leaders to move towards net zero oriented operation. Now is the time for corporations to not only commit on financial transparency, but also social responsibility transparency, as well as commit to decarbonization of the business process. Now carbon currency is as important as financial currency. There is an obvious need for leadership that is aware of the threat of climate change. Leadership that has shown commitment in green building investment.
Our world is changing. The natural state of our planet is also changing. Returning back to our routines before the pandemic is no longer possible.
The new normal in which we live in now is the start of a new paradigm, new awareness, and a new behavior. A full transition into green building and construction.
What kind of building do you currently live in? What kind of building would you provide for your children to live in? I'm Diastika Lokesworo, Ambassador for Green Building Council, Indonesia.